on behalf of the family, let me thank you for being here today. This is a very difficult time for all of them, as you can well imagine, and we appreciate you being here. Today, because of the coronavirus situation, at the end of the service, I'll dismiss in prayer, and the director will come, and we'll be dismissed row by row instead of gathering with the family down at the front, and then you can make your way on out to the parking area. Today, we have come to celebrate the life of Cameron Antonio Daca Grimm of Van Alstine, Texas. He was born on May the 3rd, 2020, and passed from this life, May the 20th of 2020. He passed away. He was born on March the 16th, 2000, in Tucson, Arizona. Cameron is survived by his wife, Casey of Van Alstine, his son Gunner of Van Alstine, his brother Chris of Denton, Texas, his brother River and Aiden Hill of Van Alstine, his mother Andrea Hill and her husband Ryan, his father Carlos Apodaca of Tucson, Arizona, his grandmother Jenny Moreland of Arizona, his grandfather, John Grimm of Tucson, Arizona, his grandparents, Antonio and Isabel Apodaca of Arizona, his great-grandmother, Evelyn Eichenberger of Arizona, and so many friends and loved ones who've gathered in this place today to love and honor his memory. One of the old-time verses of scripture for an hour such as this is found in the Old Testament book of Psalms. When the psalmist said, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Let's pray together. Father, today we come with hearts aching, seeking answers, and Father, we thank you for your presence and your power in our life. We thank you, Lord, that even though we may not understand everything that's happened in our life, Lord, that we can lean upon you and find in you our source of help and strength. Father, we thank you for Cameron. We thank you for his life. We thank you, Father, for the impact that he had on so many different people. And Father, we pray for his family today. We pray for his wife and son and mother and brothers and all these who gathered in this place. Father, just draw them close to you and fill the vacancy and void that their hearts and lives feel today. Father, we thank you for the promise that you're going to be with us, even through the very valley of the shadow of death. You provide for our comfort, our strength, and our healing. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Erica. And Erica used to babysit Cameron when he was 6 years old. He and Chris together. And I want to say how much I appreciate you doing this today, Erica. Some of you have requested an opportunity to share a word or two about Cameron. And I wonder if you're prepared to do that at this time, if you would come forward. I know this is a very difficult thing, to be able to share about someone that you love and someone who has meant so much to you. Anyone have a word that you prepared? All right, yes, come right on.
I met Chris when I was in third grade. First day came in class. Teacher sat us right down next to each other. And instantly we became friends. It wasn't until later on that, you know, I met the rest of the family and everything. And I met another family, made me feel so welcome and like open in a home. And Cameron was the sweetest dude on the planet. He had the biggest heart. And he really loved everyone around him. He made some mistakes, you know, he's a kid, he did some things. But he, you know, he learned just like everyone else. That little dude was my little brother. In my family, I was the youngest kid, so I was always the baby, you know, but man, I met that kid when he was like 3 years old, you know, 4 years old. I mean, he really didn't like, I don't know, me and Chris always teased him like, look, little brother always did. I don't know. I hadn't really, all the little pranks we played on that kid. Man, but as we grew up, man, watching him grow up and get older, become a man, it's crazy to watch. It's crazy to see. I've never seen somebody love somebody like he loved you. Never. He was over at my house like last month, 2 months ago. He stayed the weekend with me. He wouldn't shut up about Gunner. He was showing me pictures. He was talking about you. He was telling me all the things. He was showing me videos. I mean, this boy was a gem, and he was a little rough around the edges, but he had the biggest heart, and I've never met anyone like him, and I know for a fact I'll never forget this kid. He means the world to me, just like I know he meant the world to everybody else. He just wrote. Thank you.
Anyone else have any prepared remarks for today? Remarks? Reflections? Or memories? On behalf of the Apodaca family, thank you so much for being able to share today. Anyone else? Okay.
We should be playing some rap right now. If that kid taught me anything, he taught me to be okay with being myself. We, our last conversation was just this past week. And he sent me this rap repeat about loving the Lord. And if you don't love him, we just need to stab people that don't love him. Well, it's like, who else thinks that but our Cameron? Cameron brought a lot of greatness to do with this family. He loved Casey like nobody's business. He taught me a lot about being okay with not being okay. He loved his mom like, oh gosh, can't even explain it. He had a heart for people. And you were just like your dad. Great. I know all of us in our family had a great love for Cameron because he loved everyone. And just remember, he's with us. We've got Gunner and Casey, and we're going to be there for them. Andrea, Ryan, oh God, I can't even say that about Ryan Hill, Carlos. I mean, we all had a joy from Cameron. But I just want y'all to remember that he did love every one of us a little too much. So let's just pray for Casey and Gunner and my daughter, son-in-law, Carlos, everyone. We have learned so much from him. And if you take anything away from this, it's about learning how to, you have to love yourself. And not be afraid to share if you have a problem. Thank you.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to rush. Anyone else have a word you want to share? We want to give you an opportunity if you want to do that today. Amen.
I'm Casey's mom. Cameron was a son to me. I would be remiss if I didn't come up here and just say that regardless of how he passed away, Cameron, he felt things deeply. He loved passionately. He was brilliant. He was the best father that a mother-in-law could ask for from a young man. He stepped up. He loved my daughter so fervently and deeply. He's going to be an impossible act to follow, I can tell you all that. And I just want you guys to know that our family loves his family, and we just need to heal together. So thank you guys for being here.
Very impressive coming from a mother-in-law about her son-in-law. Anyone else have a word you want to share? Thank you so much. Today is only temporary. God is going to provide something better for us in the days yet to come. He's going to bring healing. He's going to trigger our minds to rejoice and to be thankful for what we have experienced in Cameron and his life and the impact that he had upon your life. And the tears that we shed today are going to give way to the laughter tomorrow and the days to come. As we remember Cameron and his zest for life and his love for life, and his love for each one of you. He lived, Christ lived and suffered and he died, but the Bible said that he was raised from the dead, and in him we have hope. As Solomon shared with us, it seems as though there is no hope. We're stuck on that up and down of life, but in Christ we have hope. There's a time to be born and a time to die. For Cameron, it was just a brief period of time. Nothing more than just a little dot in the scheme of eternity. But yet he had an impact upon the lives of everyone who knew him. For everything there's a season, a time for every matter under heaven. And then later in the same passage of scripture, he said that God made everything beautiful in his own time. He put eternity in their hearts. And then he said, I know that whatever God does, it shall be forever. Nothing can be added to it, and nothing taken away. But you see, sometimes it feels like we're not able to get off that roller coaster of life. We go through all these extremes in life, and one moment everything is going well, and the next moment we're in despair and despondency. And our heart is filled with grief and pain and suffering and sorrow. But I think we need to look at the entire picture to get the full perspective of what God does in our life. And he said that God has made everything beautiful in his own time. If only we could understand, if only we could believe that now, if only we could accept that now in the struggle that we're going through right now. In a time like this, the death of a young husband, a father, a son, a grandson, it's not a time for us to be spectacular or sensational. It's a time for us to examine the basics of life and how we relate our life, not only to him, but to one another, and how we relate our life to eternity. The scripture says that there's a time for everything, everything in its own time, everything in its own season. There are things that happen in our life that we find difficult to accept and to believe. It's easy for us to accept those good things in life. It's easy for us to accept the happy parts of life. But when it comes time to mourn, when it comes time to weep, when it comes time to die, we find it very difficult to accept that season of life. Someone has said that the darker the night, the brighter the stars, the deeper the grief, the closer is God. And I want you to know that even now, in the darkness of your life, God is near you, and God is with you, and God wants to provide for you, and he wants to strengthen you and comfort you in your time of loss. Everything, there's a season. I think at a time like this, we need to remember that God's order includes a time of weeping, and the weeping helps us to bear our sorrow, and helps us to allow those tears to flow. Even Jesus wept at Lazarus, his friend's tomb, and he knew that he was going to raise him from the dead. But the Bible said that as Jesus stood outside that tomb, he wept. And we know that our weeping is going to last for a short period of time. The psalmist said, weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes in the morning. That weeping is going to give way to the joy, as you remember Cameron and his life and the things that he did in his life and the impact that he had upon you. And this time of dark loss, and we're sick with loneliness and anguish, and our hearts cry out for an explanation, these are the times that we need to find strength. These are the times that we need to find the guidance of God's word. Other literature is able to help us and they encourage us, but only God's word is going to bring that lasting joy and lasting peace and comfort. Isaiah 40, verse 8 says, the grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of God endures forever. And then Romans 15, 4 says, for whatsoever things were written for our hearing, that we might through the patience and comfort of the scriptures find hope. And that's what we need today. We need a ray of hope. We need that hope to see us through today and tomorrow and all the tomorrows yet to come. As we read the scripture, the Holy Spirit brings comfort to our hearts and he gives us hope. We can't find hope in any other source. It's only as we look to the Word of God and the Holy Spirit of God brings us the hope that we need during such a traumatic time in our life. We have to understand that beyond this tragic event, the event that defies our human explanation, it defies anything that we can even conceive, it's beyond our senses. We can't find the purpose for this, and when we go through those times, it's only in him that we can find hope to sustain us and to get us through, to help us to see beyond the shadows to the things that are going to be revealed in the future. There are many experiences of life that we don't understand. We cry out for light, we cry out for hope, we cry out for an answer, And we began to answer the question, why did this thing happen? Now I want you to know it's okay to ask why. It's okay to ask God why. If you remember, when Jesus was hanging on the cross, he cried out, why? My God, why have you forsaken me? It's a question that's been asked for millions and millions of years, of times throughout the years and throughout the ages. And today, our hearts are filled with that same question, why? Why? Why did this happen? And we look to the Heavenly Father who is afflicted even in our afflictions. And we realize that He is the one who is able to come alongside us and bear our grief with us. He cares for you. He is concerned about your hurt. He's concerned about your grief. You remember that Jesus was 33 years of age when He died. And the Bible says, and we know from history, that He changed the entire course of history. Cameron was 20. But yet He left an indelible imprint on the lives of all people who knew Him. All of those who knew it. He made His brief life upon this earth really count. His life was just that little dot that we talked about just a moment ago. And yet the scope of eternity was within His grasp, and yet He mattered to the Lord, and God was concerned about Him. He made an impact upon your life. His brother Chris and he had a very special bond. His mom said that when Cameron was just a few weeks old, Chris was only two, and he was obsessed with Cameron. He would always sing his favorite song to Cameron, and that song was, "You've Got a Friend in Me." She went in one day to check on them. She left Cameron sitting in his little bouncy chair, and Chris was in there with him, and she went in to check on them. And when she got in there, she found Chris sitting on the floor with his legs crossed, and Cameron was in his arms, and he was rocking back and forth, and he was singing the song, "You've Got a Friend in Me." Chris and Cameron had a very special bond, and that song held a very special place in their life. Ryan, his stepfather, met Cameron one time, and Cameron was just a little boy, about 3 years of age. They were at a barbecue. And the first thing that Cameron did was to run and jump in his arms and ask him to throw him in the pool. Ryan did. And he came back again to be thrown in the pool. And he did. And he came back again to be thrown in the pool. His mother was at work, and Cameron was there with the babysitter. It wasn't you at that time, was it, Erica? Okay. Was there with a babysitter. And Ryan thought it was Cameron's mother. And soon they left, and he thought in his mind, he'll never see that little boy again. And 2 weeks later, he was invited to the same house for another barbecue on July the 4th, 2003. When he walked in, there was Cameron in the kitchen. He ran up to him, and he threw his arms around him, and he hugged him. And he called him by name. Then Cameron turned and he saw his mother, and he ran and jumped into her arms, and he called her mom. Ryan and Andrea looked at each other, and she wondered, who in the world is this man that my little boy is hugging? They got to know each other. They were impressed with each other. And they spent the rest of the evening getting to know each other, and they spent these last many years together as husband and wife. They started as a family of four and eventually grew to six. Then a couple of years ago, Cameron blessed them with a wonderful daughter-in-law. He said she's always felt like family. And because of the two of them and because of their love for each other, God gifted the parents with a grandbaby, Gunner. And he went on to say, Gunner is a mini version of Cameron, and we cherish him. Although Cameron is not with us in the physical, there is a boy that will never go away. And then to him he said, you will always be with us until we meet again. Rest easy, and reserve a spot for us at the table. Cameron and Casey met when they were in the fifth grade. And they spent so many hours together, and a relationship began, and that relationship remained strong. Keith and Tina were not really excited about that relationship. And so they did everything that they could to not like him. But they couldn't help themselves, they began to love him. It was, he was, and his mother-in-law said this, that he was such a fine young man who loved her daughter. And he loved her with a passion, he loved her with his whole heart. And she couldn't help but fall in love with him. And this is what she said about him. She said, Cameron was such a bright light that he burned out too soon. Not only was Cameron a handsome young man, but he was very compassionate. Cameron always was putting others before himself. He was never judgmental. He was bright. He was gifted. He was committed. He was one who would always stand up for the underdog. When Casey was facing difficult times in her life, and sometimes her friends would distance themselves from her, Cameron was always there. He never left her side. He was loyal and supportive. Casey told me the other night that one time they were driving down the street and he saw a homeless man on the side of the road without his shoes. He didn't say anything, but he drove down the street, made a U-turn, came back, took off his shoes, and gave them to the homeless man. He had an unselfish heart. He loved people. But he had a special love for those with disabilities, especially children with Down syndrome. His mother said that the coaches in high school had some good remarks about him. They praised his independence. They praised his strength. They praised him for knowing how to get stuff done. Anytime Cameron was told to do something, whether it was football, physical activity, or strengthening was concerned, his coaches said that he was unstoppable. And one of the coaches said to him, see that brick wall? Get through it. Cameron would find a way to get through it. He was determined. His family wants to thank Coach Shields and Coach Wren for supporting and loving Cameron as he was. A little year, over a year ago, Cameron and Casey were married in Hawaii, and God added little Gunner to their lives and to the whole family. Gunner was the apple of his eye. And he would often take Gunner into the shower with him of a morning when he would go in to get his shower. Or when he'd get home late in the evening and Gunner was already asleep, Cameron would go in and lay down by his bed and hoping that he would wake up so they could get up and play together. Cameron loved Gunner. He loved Casey. And Casey said that John 3:16 was a special scripture for Cameron because he was born on 3/16, 3/16/2000. Casey said that very special scripture was there because it was an encouragement to him. John 3, one of the most popular scriptures in all the Bible, John 3:16. That verse says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And the Bible says that the reason that God sent his Son to this world is because all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And then on down in that same book it says that the wages or the payment of our sin is death. And what a tragedy it would be if that scripture ended there, but it doesn't. It says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And then a little later in that same book it says that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Connie called me yesterday and said that Cameron had committed his heart and life to Christ when he was 6 years of age. Believed in the simple childlike faith, followed the Lord Jesus in beautiful believer's baptism. He acted upon the promise that God had given to him in a simple childlike faith. And he was born into the kingdom of God at the age of 6. The Bible tells us that once we're born into the family of God, we become a child of God. Ryan, your family increased when he came, when you got him. So he went from 4 to 6 and then more. And there's no way that he could ever be unborn from you. He could not, could never be unborn from our parents. And so when Cameron was born in the family of God, he became a child of God. And nothing would ever separate him from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. We know and we believe today that there's no better place for us to be than in the arms of Jesus, safe in his loving arms. And I want you to know Cameron is in the arms of Christ. He's in the presence in the Father's house. I know you're hurting today, and I know that you're going to miss Cameron more than words can ever say. I know that. But I want you to know that God knows you, and God knows your grief, and God is concerned about the hurt in your heart. And I want you to know that God does care for you. As a matter of fact, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7 says, cast all of your care upon him, for he cares for you. And God wants you to cast your hurt and your cares upon him, your frustration upon him, because he cares for you. He doesn't want you to go through this tragic loss all by yourself. God wants to be with you, to comfort and sustain you. I want to encourage you to lean upon him. When we feel weak and when we feel brokenhearted and we feel like our whole world is coming in, I want to encourage you to lean upon him and trust in his strength and his comfort. God will say to you, you've got a friend in me. He will get you through this. In this lifetime, and ultimately, he's going to bring you to that place that he's prepared for those who know him. Let me encourage you to embrace his love. Trust him. Commit your heart and life to him and follow him. On the evening before his death, Jesus gathered all of his disciples around him and he said, let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And whether I go, you know, and the way, you know. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. You see, death is that gateway through which we must pass in order to come into the very presence of God. And the other day when Cameron closed his eyes in physical death, he opened his eyes in eternal life in the presence of the Father. Let's pray together. Our Father, we thank you that in times like these, a time when our hearts are filled with deep sorrow and grief, Father, we confess our lack of understanding. We don't understand why we're here today. We don't understand why our hearts grieve the way they do. Lord, your ways are so much above our ways. And we cannot see the big picture, but Lord, we know that you do. Lord, remind us of your power. Remind us of your love. Remind us of your grace. Remind us of your comfort. Give us faith to trust in you. To trust in you beyond our sight. Through the Lord Jesus, our Lord.